Peace, love, everybody, and welcome to Godwin's TV. I'm your host, Reverend Sonia. Today I have a special guest. He is actually one of the people who does a lot of the behind-the-scenes stuff at Godwin's TV here. He does a lot of the computer work and a lot of the moving things and stereo stuff and stuff like that, right? Okay, and his name is Bryce Isaac. So welcome, Bryce. Now Bryce had a very miraculous day, and that's what we would like to talk about today. This was, I'm not sure how many years ago, but
February 25th, 2006.
Okay, so it was a few years ago. And Bryce had been called into work on a day that he doesn't usually work. And then what, you worked for a few hours and then you were told to go
I was
home?
Doing inventory on a Saturday.
Okay. And then you were sent home after everybody was done?
Or? After everybody was done. Told, okay, yep. Thanks for coming in.
Okay.
Have a good day.
Mm-hmm.
And I was on my way home on a flat, straight stretch of road, always drive.
Right.
And I hit a patch of black ice.
Okay.
And my truck went into the, halfway into the ditch.
Wow.
And so I didn't want to slow down or else I'd be stuck.
Right.
And I could see an approach ahead.
Mm-hmm.
So I figured I could use the approach, get back up onto the road.
Right.
Well, it was a good idea at the time. So I kept my speed up, and right before I got to the approach, I shot down into the bottom of the ditch.
Oh, wow.
So I was doing 80, 90 kilometers an hour.
Right.
And went straight up, straight down, a distance of 50 feet. I hit the approach at an angle about like this.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. And then went end over end, then barrel rolled over top of barbed wire fence.
Mm-hmm.
And I should have actually been dead multiple times over.
Okay. Let me just stop you a sec. You went up in the air?
Yeah. Straight up in the air and then came down on the nose.
And as you're up in the air, what were you thinking?
You know the Dukes of Hazzard?
Woo!
It was like that going up.
Uh-huh.
And then coming down, as I was looking at the ground, and it's getting closer and closer, I was like, oh, crap. Now I'm going to have to replace the front end. So it hit on the ground, and you know how your seatbelt locks up right away as soon as it hits something on the front end?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was wearing my seatbelt, but it didn't.
It didn't lock up?
No. If it had, the entire roof of the truck came down, bent the driver's headrest all the way back.
Oh, yikes.
So I would have been not decapitated, but it would have crushed my head like a watermelon.
Wow. So you would not have survived to tell the story.
Not at all.
Mm-hmm.
No chance.
Okay.
But I had my hand on the top of the steering wheel.
Right.
And I hit on the front end and I went down like this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And at that time I didn't have a shifter knob on it.
Okay.
On the shifter. So it was just the stick sticking up.
Okay.
When my seatbelt locked up, my eye was about that far from the stick of the shifter.
Hold it. Your seatbelt locked up when you were down?
When I was down like this and it stopped
wow.
right there.
Holy. That's incredible. Okay.
And there was also a metal trim piece across the mm-hmm. front of the windshield there.
Right.
On the inside.
Mm-hmm.
That metal piece actually came down and gouged into the top of the steering wheel right where my hand was.
Oh, wow.
So I should have lost all these fingers across here.
Mm-hmm. Goodness sakes.
I actually have one little tiny scar. I don't know if you can even... Right there.
Yeah.
That's what I walked away with.
Wow, that's incredible. Okay. So, your truck has landed. And everything comes to a stop.
Well, even before it came to a stop,
okay.
I'm rolling over and over and over and, you know, like slow motion just goes on and on. I wasn't freaking out or scared, anything like that. I was just okay, this can end any time. Mm-hmm. Then everything stopped for a second. And I was like, oh good, it's all done. And then it hit again on the passenger side. Okay, back now.
Holy.
When is this going to be over?
Right.
So it was just more patiently waiting for everything to finally come to a stop.
Mm-hmm.
And you know that really dumb thought that immediately goes through your mind after a crash?
Okay.
Well, everything stopped. I picked my head up and I looked out what used to be my windshield. Mm-hmm. And the little windshield wipers are going and they're just the sticks.
Right.
And I was like, oh crap, and I need to get new windshield wipers too. I just replaced those.
Oh dear. Oh my. Okay, so now you're finally at a stop.
Yep.
And then what happened? You had to get out, obviously.
Yeah. So, with the roof and the doors and everything, we're all metals all intertwined and everything. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so I just click, off comes the seatbelt.
Right.
I was like, I don't know, I'll probably have to climb out the window or something, but I'll try it anyways. And click, door opens, no problem.
Oh, okay.
Okay, whatever. So I got out, and I closed the door again, and the metal is actually fused all together there, so it shouldn't have actually been able to open.
So it was a miracle that you were able to even just get out the door.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow, that's amazing. Okay. Okay, and so there you are standing where? In the middle of the field, or?
I was way out in the field.
Mm-hmm.
And so I walked the 200 feet or so,
mm-hmm,
back up to the highway. Mm-hmm. And this is on flat, straight stretch of road. You can see for miles.
Okay.
And
okay, so this is the part that I really want to listen to. Like, you're standing on the road and there's nobody around. Okay, go ahead.
So I wanted to get out of there. So I looked this way, and back this way. There was nobody there, nobody there. When I turned back this way, there was a truck right there and slowing down.
Wow.
And
you had not seen this truck from like...
No, you could see for miles. Hmm. Just, there's no entrances onto the road, there's no nothing. Came out of nowhere.
Do you remember what the color of the truck was?
Not offhand, no.
Okay, that's okay. Go ahead.
But this guy slows down and stops.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, oh, do you need to ride home or to the hospital? And I was like, what? What do you mean? He was like, that's your truck out there, isn't it? Yeah. Well, do you want to go home or to the hospital? And I was thinking about it. I was like, you know what? Oh, before that even, while mm-hmm I was walking up to the road.
Right.
Automatically, instinctually, I was just... making my mind work. I was thinking, okay, what day is it? This day. Okay, what time is it? This time. What was I last doing? Okay, this. What's the president's name? Who cares? On to the next one.
So you were just reviewing to make sure that your mind was functioning okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so I was making sure that, yes, I have my wits about me, yes, I know what day it is, I know who I am, I know who my parents are.
Right.
Everything is all in check and everything.
Mm-hmm, right.
And I actually learned a couple of years after that the reason why you have a trauma victim or something like that, you're in first aid training,
mm-hmm,
you're told, ask them a bunch of questions.
Okay.
To keep their mind
focused and...
I can't remember what it's called.
Mm-hmm. That's okay.
But they kind of zone out and...
Mm-hmm. Just to make sure that they're with you, sort of a deal. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And to keep them conscious and everything. So right. I was automatically doing that to myself.
Right.
Without even realizing it.
Wow. Okay.
So anyways.
Anyways, the truck and...
This guy in the truck, he says, okay, well, I'll give you a ride to the hospital then. Said, okay, hospital works.
Mm-hmm.
And so I got into his truck and we started off towards Lacombe. And he reaches down on the dash, grabs his cell phone. He's like, here, give your parents a call. They're going to be worried. Mm-hmm. You don't have a cell phone, do you? I'm like, no, I don't have one right now. Because there was a time when I just didn't have a cell phone. It was quite freeing, actually.
That's so weird. How would he know that you didn't have a cell phone? You know?
Yeah. And yeah. I have never seen this guy before or since.
Huh. Okay.
But, so he hands me a cell phone. He's like, okay, here's the number. Go ahead and press send.
And he had our number.
Yeah.
In his phone.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Okay.
And so I knew for a fact when I called my mom, she was going to be freaking out and everything. And that was just a conversation I did not want to have right then. So I gave
that
him.
That would be me.
Yeah. So it rings, picks up. Hello, Mom. Meet me at Lacombe Hospital. Don't ask any questions. Just meet me there. Click. That was it.
Okay.
And so I gave him back his phone. I said, thanks. He was like, oh, yeah, no problem. By the way, your cousin Tamara, yeah, she's doing pretty good. She's up in Edmonton now. And, your uncle, he's doing all right as well. And so, and he kept going on like this, and I was like...
So he is telling you about your relatives.
Yeah.
Some of them that, like, we haven't necessarily seen
in ages. Yeah, like some I hadn't seen for years, and so he was letting me know, oh yeah, everybody's doing good, this person's doing this, and this person's doing that. And so I'm looking at him, I'm thinking, do I know you from somewhere? He was like, well, I've been around since you were just a little baby, and I've been looking out for you. Oh, okay. And then he kept on talking. Okay, yeah, well, I was there when you're at your baseball game and you got struck out. But, you know, that was all right because the next week you got a home run. It was all good. So, but yeah, it was really nice talking to the guy.
Right.
And so then we got to the hospital and he was asking me, well, are you fine or do you want me to come in with you? I said, maybe just come in with me just until I have a chance to get checked in and stuff. Because what happens if, oh, they're closed.
Yeah, right.
And I'm stuck there.
Right.
Highly doubt it, but you never know.
Mm-hmm.
So he's like, oh yeah, sure, no problem. So he comes with me in, and at that time when you walked into Lacombe Hospital, you would walk through the front door, and there's one reception desk here, and then there's another reception desk around the corner.
Right.
And so I went up to the first reception desk. I told the lady there, okay, I just rolled my truck. I'm feeling fine, but I wanted to just get checked out. And she said, okay, well, go around the corner there to the other reception desk. That's the emergency reception desk. And tell them the same thing and a doctor will see you right away.
Right.
And so he came with me from there and around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And so I told the lady there the same thing. She said, okay, well, you can go right over here and have a seat in the waiting area.
Okay, so you and the guy are standing at the second reception desk, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Standing there, like, from me to you away.
Right.
And I looked over to him. I said, you know what? I think I'm good from here. I'm all checked out and everything. I think I'm good. I didn't even say thank you yet. And so I just glanced over to the waiting area just to see
if there was
an available seat.
Okay, gotcha.
And in the time that I just checked over there quick and then turned back to say thank you, and the guy's gone.
He disappeared.
Yep, just gone like that. That's like if I were to look at you, and you're gone.
How did you feel? Were you freaked out, or?
Well, I wasn't really freaked out or anything. It was just kind of trying to pass it off in my mind, or, oh, maybe he just went around the corner. Like, I'm not going to worry myself about that. I probably have bigger problems to worry
Great.
About. So,
wow.
Never seen the guy before or since.
That's incredible. Okay. So, fast forward, the doc to never mind my reaction.
Oh, it was a good one. So I'm lying there on the hospital bed. The doctor's, you know, running some tests or whatever, waiting to get copies of the x-rays and stuff back. And my mom and dad walk in. My mom walks in. Bryce, what are you doing? I'm just
yes.
giving me the third degree.
Yes, we kind of ripped him a new one. And he's like, I don't care. I'm having some experience here, you know? And I had no idea, you know, about this guy or what. I think you tried to tell me, but I just thought, you know, some guy just gave you a ride. I didn't realize that it was like that.
Yeah.
And then...
So on the way into the hospital, did you guys see the truck on the... like off the side of the road in the field there?
I don't remember that.
Okay.
I don't remember seeing it. I remember seeing it later on, you
yeah.
know, like going there, but no, I don't remember seeing that.
Because I remember there was a whole bunch of snow on the ground and everything, and you could see my tracks
mm-hmm.
go up and off the approach.
Right.
And there was no sign anything touching the ground
mm-hmm.
until where I hit on the front end, then was rolling over and everything.
Right.
And
yeah.
I thought it was maybe 20, 30 feet, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And a friend of mine actually went back later
mm-hmm.
to where it was, and he actually measured.
Oh, wow.
From where I left the ground to any sign of anything hitting the ground, and it was 50 feet.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
So, yeah, I was really going.
Okay, so carrying on, the doctor on call at that time examined you, and what did he do?
Well, also happened to be a guy that I knew from church.
Mm.
So he was like, well, hey, Bryce, how you doing? Why are you here again?
Yeah, there's been a few.
Yeah, when I broke my arm and
mm-hmm.
when I got stitches for the first time.
Yeah.
Always seems to be him.
Yeah.
But anyways,
mm-hmm.
so he took because I was in a vehicle accident, wanted to take some x-rays just to make sure, spine and neck and everything, just to make sure nothing was wrong, and everything seemed fine to me. It just,
mm-hmm.
you know, when it feels like when you need to crack your neck, just
mm-hmm.
like
right.
that.
Like that.
And
sorry.
I would try and it just wouldn't crack, and that feeling was just always there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of a gritty, kind of a, it's just something not right there.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But it's fine, whatever, pass it off.
Right.
And so he got the x-rays back and everything, and he took a quick look through them. Oh yeah, everything looks fine. Go ahead. Just take it easy.
Right.
Okay, yeah, sure. And I was thinking maybe this feeling is a little bit of whiplash or something.
Okay.
And I was actually supposed to be on stage that night with
right.
a band that I was with, the LA Rock Band,
mm-hmm.
playing
which
bass.
Which is a Christian rock band specifically for youth, okay?
So, yeah, mm-hmm. and we were supposed to do a fundraising dinner and
mm-hmm.
everything. And I was thinking, you know, in light of the situation, I think I'm just going to take it easy. Won't worry about playing bass.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go, but I'll just be at the dinner and
right. So the doctor sent you home with no neck brace, no braces on your arms, no bandages, nothing.
No, the only thing I had was this one's little scar right here, which wasn't even worth a Band-Aid.
Right, okay.
And I think I had a cut just on the top of my head or something like mm-hmm. that.
Okay.
That had a few drops of blood. That was it.
Right, okay.
So no need for any neck brace, bandages, or anything like that. Mm-hmm. I'm just out of truck.
Right, yeah. So you went to the fundraiser.
Well, actually, before I went to the fundraiser, I went to my friend Steve's house.
Okay.
Which he was the, I think it was two of his family members were in the band.
Oh, okay.
And his place was like, everybody gathers there.
Oh, okay.
And right. You needed something to do, hey, we'll go out in the garage, we'll just go ahead and chop up these three bikes and make a chopper-style bicycle out of them just for something to do. Right. And so I went ahead and went over there, and Jorgen was there, who was the drummer, and Kathy and Steve was all there. And so I told him, oh yeah, I rolled my truck today, and, you know, I'm feeling a little stiff and whatever. And they said, oh, well, are you going to be able to play tonight, or are you feeling all right? And I was like, you know, I think I'm just gonna take it easy. If you could find another bass player for just tonight, that'd be really great for me. And they said, oh yeah, we'll give this guy a call. I'm sure, considering everything, mm-hmm. he wouldn't have any problem with it. So they were able to get another guy lined mm-hmm. up, no problem at all whatsoever.
Okay.
So we went to the fundraiser and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was there listening to the band and having dinner, and I actually, at that fundraiser, met one of my now best friends, Jeremy.
Ah, okay.
Met him for the first time there.
Yeah. Okay, that's awesome. Huh. Okay. So then, that was on a Saturday.
Yep, that was Saturday night.
Okay. So, the doctors were not going to be able to look at the x-rays until Monday.
Well, they had looked at the x-rays, just quick flip through. Oh yeah, everything mm-hmm. seems fine. There's nothing. Oh yeah, there's one vertebrae here that mm-hmm. is now dust or anything like that.
Oh, there was nothing like that. Okay. So Monday, I think you and I were preparing to get into the car to go to your work to talk about your accident or something like that, or something like that. And the phone rang.
Well, what it was, I had actually called into work
mm-hmm.
that day, and I said, you know what? I'm feeling a little bit stiff yet. In light of the situation, I think I'm going to milk this. I'm going to take the day off work.
Oh, wow. That's a big deal for him.
And you know, considering the fact I don't have a vehicle to get there right now mm-hmm. either,
right.
It kind of makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So I called in, yeah, I rolled my truck, I'm fine, I'm just going to take the day and I'll be in tomorrow, no problem.
Mm-hmm.
They said, oh yeah, that's fine, no problem, take as long as you need, whatever. So we were preparing to go into town or something
somewhere. I can't remember what it was. It was something... Maybe it had something to do with the insurance or something. I don't know.
I'm not sure. But, so we're just about to close the door behind us, and I'm like,
yeah.
I think I hear the phone ring. Oh, go grab the phone. So we're upstairs, go grab the phone, and it's the hospital.
Right.
They said, Bryce, we took another look at your x-rays. You need to get into Red Deer Hospital right now. They're waiting for you.
What?
Okay, hey mom, change of plans. We're going to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
So we went into Red Deer Hospital, and we went up to the front desk. I was like, yeah, I'm Bryce Isaac. Apparently you're waiting for me. Yeah, there's a gurney over here. Get on it right now. We're going. What? Mm-hmm. Okay, whatever. And so x-rays and x-rays and CAT scan, yeah, more x-rays.
I think there was an MRI in there or something.
No, it was just CAT scan.
CAT scans? Okay.
But it was like three dozen x-rays and stuff like mm-hmm. this. It was just nuts.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still feeling fine. Like, a little stiff.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I'm fine. And so it was a couple hours later, I think.
Yeah, and I'm in the hurry up and waiting room. You know,
yeah.
Just kind of waiting for all of this to, you know, just let us know what's going on, if you need anything, sort of deal.
And no, we weren't even in the waiting room. There was a couple of chairs in the hallway there.
In the hallway, yeah.
And so we're sitting there in the hallway. I think I was on the other side of you, and we're sitting there looking around, and okay, so, whatever. And this doctor comes out
mm-hmm.
with a file in his hand, and he's flipping through a file. And he's like, you know what? It doesn't look good. But you need to get to U of A Hospital right now. They're waiting for you.
Which is in the big city, Edmonton, which is another hour and a half away.
And he was like, yeah, they're waiting for you. You can drive up there right now, or we can take you by ambulance.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I don't see any need for an ambulance at all whatsoever. Like, we can drive up there, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
So we're like, no, we'll drive up there. He was like, okay, well, put this on your neck. And he puts one of these little foam things on my neck.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, so just don't turn, don't look around, don't. And I was like, what? I can't do this? No, don't do that. What?
Yikes.
Okay. Which I'd already been doing, and, you know, mm-hmm. kind of trying to crack my neck, and it just mm-hmm. wouldn't. You know, I've been doing that for the past couple days, so.
Yes. Because, remember, that was on a Saturday. This is Monday we're talking about, you know, so.
Already went to bed, rolled around.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that was Saturday, and this is Monday already.
Yeah.
So, what did the doctor tell us?
Just that, we opted to drive up there on our own.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't really see the need to pay for
an ambulance.
We
was can a little just panicked. But the doctor just said that it doesn't look good, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
He said, it doesn't look good. Put this thing around my neck. Get up to U of A Hospital. Like, they're waiting for you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Usually when you go into a hospital, you say, can I see a doctor? And you sit and you wait for them.
Mm-hmm.
Not,
exactly.
Okay, the hospital is waiting for you. For when you get there, they're ready.
Right. Yeah.
That's a first. Mm-hmm. Not only once in one day, twice in one day.
Yeah. So we get back in the car, and I'm driving. As fast as I can. On from Red Deer to our local town, my husband is working, so I'm thinking, okay, it's only gonna be like another minute to stop by and pick up your father, right? Yeah. So, and what was really fortunate is because the place where he worked at the time, he could have been anywhere in the county. But he happened to be at the office at the time. So, and again, we didn't have a cell phone to call him or anything like that. So we stopped in, picked him up as fast as we could, and said, drive. And we went roaring up to Edmonton. Now, were you in any pain at all on the weekend?
None? Not at all whatsoever.
None.
Just a little tiny bit stiff, you know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Like when you wake up in the morning and you're sleeping in a weird position, after you stretch it out a little bit and, okay, yeah, I'm good now, you stretch, okay, yeah, I'm feeling better now, and that's about it.
Right. Okay, so we finally get up to Edmonton. We are parked in the designated parking area. We pay for our parking, the three of us. And I'm thinking, your sister goes to the university right next door to the hospital. And I'm thinking, how on earth am I going to get a hold of her? Because, again, we don't have a cell phone. She's in the dorms. You need permission to get in the dorms. In the University of Hospital, there's thousands of people there coming in and out and everything. There's thousands of people in the university who could be in any given class at whatever time. So how on earth am I going to get a hold of her? She, on the other hand, had a cell phone. So we get out of the vehicle and we are walking across the street to the
front doors.
To the, I think it was the emergency. Or we had to, I know they had changed the emergency area and we didn't realize it.
Yeah.
But we were going to the front doors, walking across the street, and who should we see? But my brother.
Yep.
And he's walking towards us, and I was like, ah! So he joined us, went back into the hospital, because he was at the hospital on a regular basis for other reasons, right? Totally legitimately so. He lent us his cell phone. We phoned our daughter, and then she came over and joined us, and that was yet another miracle. Okay, so we go into the emergency once we find out where it was, and
so